watching on the TV. I know they're all thinking I'm so round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy. Can't you see I'm NASA nerdy? Look at me, I'm NASA nerdy. I wanna float above the thermosphere, but so far gravity has got me stuck here. Think I'm just too round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy. I'm just too NASA nerdy. Look at me, I'm NASA nerdy.
First in my class, space, can't believe. Landed my module, first try with these. Buzz Aldrin cereal, yes please.
Keep you flattered.
I'll take blue marble chief.
My curves never spin, to the contrary. You find that it's quite rotationary.
All my lightsabers are scary. Bill Nye's up in my library. My GoPro footage is totally pimped out. Got people begging for my round spaces. I've seen curves over long places. Ain't got no Vinox, but I still solve cases.
I outrank all the planets in endless ways. Love NASA orbit, I could watch for days. Look at the sweet moves, just stay amazed. Traversing so fast at the place. No play into the cosmos, I haven't run. At gravity, well I'm number one. I do eclipses just for fun. I got a lot of curves and a multi-gun.
Close encounters is my favorite ringtone. I can sure kick your butt at space con. Interrogate any alien you bring on. Fluent in star charts and evolution.
The part I read from. Revolving in the movies. I know in my heart they think I'm round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Flat Earth Podcast. Alongside me, Dave, inside the rabbit hole, and we are back once again for another hour or so of Flat Earth audio. Dave, how are you this week?
You know, that is such an interesting question, Jay. Last week.
It's always a loaded question, right?
Yeah. Last week, I think I was a little bit agitated, might you say? But since then, I've thought about it and I found a way to make myself much calmer, which is I look around at all of the people around me and realize that they think they're on a spinning ball flying through space. And they were created when nothing exploded and became everything. So that makes me feel fantastic. How are you?
That makes you feel better. Last week, it made you feel terrible.
No, no. Well, last week, you know, it's just so how you look at it, you know?
Right.
It depends on how you look at it, you know?
Because I think last week when you said you were so frustrated, that was the exact reason you gave.
Yeah. It's like somebody watching their house burn down and the one person's like, oh my God, this is horrible. And the other person looking at it going, oh my God, it's the greatest thing ever. And that's because it was a divorced couple and the husband.
Right.
Was,
I was about to, yeah,
was
I was
saying,
about to
hey,
go with
the thing ever.
I was about to use the old, my wife, his wife left him, you know, do I say congrats or condolences, you know?
Yeah.
Depends on how you look at it. Glad you're feeling better about that this week. We got a lot to talk about. I believe we've got somebody joining us right now because you sent out the link for other people to join us, right?
Yeah, we were supposed to have Paul on a plane and a big apology from you, Jay.
Yes, I fell asleep.
Where we blew Paul off three times. We're sitting and waiting for Curious Jay to show up, and he never did.
Yeah, last night I crashed early. My bad.
Yeah.
And then so and Paul, we do apologize. I'm sorry about that.
And of course, tonight he can't make it. So I sent the link randomly to a whole bunch of people. And our first taker is Matt Long from Flatworth. Matt?
Yeah. Totally just humbled to be the third or fourth, you know, option on this deal right now.
You were like the ninth, my friend. Ninth.
Oh, man.
You weren't even close to three or four.
There's nothing wrong with top 10, Matt.
We'll see you guys.
If anybody recognizes, Matt has sent us some very interesting speak pipes, which we have featured after our commercial spot, which I think kind of make the show, to be honest. So welcome, Matt. Thanks for coming.
Thanks.
And Matt, Jay, I don't know if you know, but Matt and I at the conference in November in Denver, will be doing a side seminar on how to talk to family and friends and how to do outreach without becoming extradited from everybody you know. What's the word? Extradited? Or
ostracized.
Ostracized. Thank you.
Conspiracy theorist to conspiracy therapist.
Thing is, I think that's a great idea for a seminar. I just hope they get this week's Dave, not last week's.
Me too, but there's no guarantees. There's no guarantees. Although I will tell you from my experience last year at the conference, it is such a great experience. You don't have an upset moment the entire time you're there. It's really one of the most memorable experiences of my life. It was just an amazing, amazing experience. Matt, how did you feel about that?
I'm sure people, you know, you end up getting in a conversation with another flat earther and it's something super unique. I've kind of made it my mission to have those conversations every day. But for people that don't get to have those every day, going to a flat earth conference allows you to have those. And to be, you know, you and I were walking through the bar, Dave, noticing how nobody was watching Thursday night football, right? You know, nobody was watching the TV. Everyone was engaged in conversation, talking about things that actually matter, as opposed to whatever teams were playing that night.
Talk about outreach. Matt sponsored the local Little League team. What did you do with the in the brochure? Tell everybody.
Oh, yeah. So some.
Wait, are you telling me there's a Flat Earth Little League team out there?
No. Almost. So, they're probably going to be Flat Earthers after you hear what Matt did.
Okay. Go ahead.
I get a phone call. I do a few things. I've got two or three businesses, but I also kind of have a day job. And I get a call about sponsoring a local high school baseball team. And, you know, they're saying, you know, we got this for sale and this for sale, talking about like, you know, banners in the outfield and stuff like that. And I tell them, look, we don't really advertise, but I've got some stuff I do on the side. It's kind of like an educational, you know, science and technology deal. I'd love to be a part of it. And so this guy says, look, you know, if you buy this 4x6 banner, we'll also give you the front inside cover because it's the only thing we don't have left. And so I was like, deal. So I bought it. And so the front inside cover of the Benbrook High School Bobcats baseball program is a picture of the Chicago skyline with a giant Flat Earth. You know, I'm from Fort Worth. Fort Worth plus Flat Earth equals Flat Worth, with a big flatworth.com logo on there saying why we shouldn't be able to see the Chicago skyline from 60 plus miles away. And it's also on a 4x6, you know, banner in the outfield, by the way.
Wow.
Isn't that amazing?
That's pretty bold, man. That's cool. You're going to have to get some, you need to get some pictures of that once it's up.
Yeah, I'll shoot it. I've got it. I've heard through the grapevine that there's been some murmuring from some kids about how ridiculous it is that was in their program. You know, I have zero heartburn over the deal. So
I think we're going to see more and more things like that. Right now on our website, theflatearthpodcast.com, we have a new page called FE Artwork. And we have different signs and cards that you can download. Andrew Lanks, another flat earther, created this amazing trifold brochure that you can download and print out on your printer or bring it to Staples or your local printer and print a bunch of them. And it's amazing. It's the top 10 flat earth proofs. It's a great introduction to somebody. They can either pick it up by themselves or if you're talking to somebody and when you're done, say, here, take this. And it gives them links to good channels and good websites, including ours. Also, you can there's a link there if you want to customize it, if you want to change the websites, change anything on it. Andrew will do that for free for you. Just click the link and let him know what you want changed.
Yeah, if you haven't been over to theflatearthpodcast.com, you need to check it out. Brand new design. Click up there at the top. What is it? I think it's artwork, like you said.
FE artwork.
Yeah. And I really like the idea of the trifold. I mean, I really do, because we were talking about this earlier today, Dave. You know, the flat earth is such a loaded topic. It's just, it's great to have, you know, business cards out there to say, hey, earth is flat, just to get people's attention. But if you really want anyone to like look into it, you need a trifold brochure. I mean, you need to be able to hit a few points to get them thinking.
Yeah, absolutely. And there's also the must-see videos page, and we have categories. So if you're looking for something about the sun, sunsets, or whatever, click that category, and it'll sort them out for you. And it's all of the best videos. We're adding more and more every day. It's a great resource since YouTube is slowly eliminating all the good stuff.
Yes. And speaking of one of the best experiences, you said the Flat Earth Conference, one of the best experiences of your life. But then you actually said earlier today, you said you had an experience sitting on the beach recently. And I wanted to hear about that.
Yeah. Paige and I went down to the beach. It was a beautiful, calm day, high tide. So the water's really right up to the, you know, up to almost the road level. We have a very low lying park. and the sun was about an hour from sunset, and it was calm day. The water was really flat, and the breeze was going to the left, then it would stop and switch directions. It was going back and forth, and we're sitting there seeing how peaceful and utterly still it was, and you could just see the sun moving away. It's obvious. There's nothing, there's no other way to see it. But then I looked at the other people there, and I'm thinking, they think they're falling over backwards faster than the speed of sound, and that gravity is holding the air column to go with that spin, which makes no sense. How does the breeze keep switching directions? It's just such utter nonsense. And we're having this revelation, thinking that if we told people what we're experiencing, they would think that we're crazy.
Oh, they do. Many, many of them do.
Tonight, the moon came up. It was like 3/4 moon. And you could see the moon just circling around. You know, it's going by us. But we're supposed to believe that the moon is falling around the Earth every 28 days, where it does one rotation every 28 days, which keeps the face of it facing us. When in fact, you see it, you can just see it. It's going, it's making laps around us. I mean,
oh, yeah.
How do people in 2018 still think we live on a spinning ball?
Well, and two, Dave, like 90% of the people I know, smart people, think that the phases of the moon are caused by the Earth.
The Earth's shadow. Yep.
I know. Such a,
yeah, the Earth's shadow.
That's a huge misconception out there. I know. I hear that all the time, Matt.
The reason they believe we live on a spinning ball is because they don't know the model. If they knew the model of the spinning ball like we do, you would be a flat earther.
That's right. I couldn't agree with you more as far as that one statement you just said right there. And that is the problem. You know, I don't blame anyone for thinking that we're on a spinning ball because of the way we were all brought up and because of how little we were actually taught about the model. It's like our favorite topic of the seasons, Dave. You know, we're taught about the tilt, but we're not taught about the distance.
Tilt the marshmallow, Charlie.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. Just tilt it. Just give it a little tilt.
Greatest line ever.
I love the marshmallow thing. I've told that to so many people. I think that's gold. But you're right. I mean, like, people had to be told they were on a spinning ball. They couldn't experience it. They had to be told that.
Yeah, and not just told. I mean, they had to be told at the most impressionable age possible, over and over and over by authorities. It's so not fair. Yes. So I never hold it against people for thinking we're on a ball. But if they knew the model, if they really knew the model that science says that they're on, yeah, I'd say, what are you crazy? You're not sitting at the beach falling backwards. I totally agree. You know, just the other day, I've got a 5.5-year-old son who, when the kids come home and they say anything about gravity or planets or whatever,
dad pulls his hair out.
I lose it, right? I totally lose it. But you can't really confront them about it. You just, oh. The other day I hear one of them saying something about gravity and I couldn't hear what he was saying. And my wife just, I gave her the look like, oh, here we go again. And, but this time she says, I didn't hear what he specifically said, but then she goes, go tell your daddy that. Go tell your daddy that. Did you hear that, daddy? And I'm like, what did he say? And he said, well, and he's 5. And he said, if gravity pulls us all down, how is it so easy for me to just lift my arm up?
Good answer. Smart kid.
And I said,
but don't worry, they'll beat that smartness.
I know. That's what I say. Exactly what I said. I was like, you see, there is a glimmer of, like, you know, even that age, you can't help but question it, but they're going to beat it out of you and just beat that globe and that gravity into you until 20 years from now, you go, flat earth. Yeah, right.
He's so far ahead for even asking the question.
I think we might have all been. I think we were all probably, like, when we were first taught this stuff, we probably all said, wait, that doesn't make sense. And then, again, your parents, your older siblings, every single teacher, every authority in your life, every adult in your life tells you, yeah, that's a silly question. It's a ball. It's gravity, blah, blah, blah. And boom, We all become Globers.
When we were taught about gravity, a teacher brought us out and did the bucket on the rope with the water in it and spun it around. And he said, that's gravity pulling you towards the center. And he's the center. And I'm like, but the water's on the inside of the bucket. And he looked at me and he scratched his head. I think I told this, but he looked at me and he goes, that's a good question, but don't worry about it. And that was basically the end of it. But here, yeah. I got a thing about gravity. So mass creates gravity, right? And pulls everything together. This is what we're told. So just look at the Earth. Who told the atom that's at the center of the Earth that you are the center and everything comes towards you? Because think about an atom halfway between the center and the crust. Why doesn't everything go towards him? Right?
I know the answer.
Go ahead.
What is the answer?
Chuck Norris.
But if you think about it, gravity should cancel itself out because every atom will be pulling everything towards it wherever it is. I mean, how does the center one get designated the center? Who told them that?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know who made the call. I tell you what, speaking of center of the Earth, though, almost every week I say that that's another one of the topics that I would love to ask science. Where's your proof of, right? I mentioned that many, many times. Prove to me that a gradient gaseous atmosphere can exist next to a vacuum, or prove to me that the whole tilt the marshmallow, Charlie, prove to me that you can heat something up further away just by tilting it. Speaking of the center of the Earth, that's this week's question I want answered from science. And that is, I was reading this again the other day about the magnetism of the Earth, right? The cause of our magnetic field comes from our molten iron core. Again, we've mentioned this on the show. The Keurig point for iron is like 1,050 degrees. And we're told in every science article, book, Wikipedia, everything, that the core of the Earth, the inner core where the molten iron supposedly exists, does anybody remember the temperature? 5,400 degrees Celsius.
Wow.
So it's 4,000 degrees over the Keurig point, and the Keurig point, C-U-R-I-G, I believe, is the point at which a metal loses its magnetic properties. So I want science to show me an experiment, any scale, any size, how you can heat up a metal that is magnetic to 5 times its Keurig point, and it still produce a magnetic field strong enough to go all the way from pole to pole around the Earth, etc. That's my question for science this week.
Is it Keurig point?
Yeah, I never spell it right. It's Keurig.
Like the coffee maker?
The Keurig.
Keurig point, whatever it is. Isn't the definition of that point the point where it loses magnetism?
Yes.
So you're saying something that's 5 times the point where it loses magnetism has magnetism? Do you hear how idiotic of a question that is? Because the whole thing, I'm not calling you an idiot. I'm just saying the entire gravity magnetic field thing is idiotic.
Yes. And it's Curie, C-U-R-I-E. And this is like just one of those things where you can look up 3 things on Wikipedia and see the glaring contradiction involved here. You know, look up Curie temperature of iron. And it'll tell you it's 1,000 degrees. Look up what Keurig temperature is. And that is the temperature at which certain materials lose their magnetic properties, right?
Do you know what science's answer is?
What? Gravity?
Nope. Change the subject.
Refraction.
No. Change the subject. Just go on to the next subject. They just don't answer.
Yeah, right. We don't have PhDs. Period. We're not smart enough to – we wouldn't understand. Yeah, I want to know how a metal can be heated up in the center of this ball to 5 times its Curie point and yet still produce the magnetic field that it supposedly does. That's my question for science out there. So anyone who sends us the trolls who send us emails and speak pipes that don't agree with us, go out and figure that out for me before you send your next email.
Hey, speaking of trolls and stuff, last week's show, or you went off on selling gold in Argentina.
Yes.
Because of the different weight. Well, it was pointed out many times that gold is not sold by weight. It's sold by mass. And so it uses a balancing scale. So it doesn't matter where you sell it. It's going to be the same amount of mass.
Hmm.
It doesn't matter if the gravity was double or half, it's the same amount of mass. Weight is done with the spring, and mass is done with balance. What's that, Matt?
It's not according to Newton's.
So it's not ounces of gold as in weight.
They measure it by mass. And so the gravity at that point wouldn't matter at all. Plus, also, even though the gravity's less, they adjust the scales to wherever it is to make sure it zeroes out. So your entire plan, which wasn't going to work anyway, is null.
So we're not doing the boating business.
We're not. We're out.
Yeah, I think it's going to work. I'm on board with it. I think it's
pretty sound. Yeah.
I think it is.
Hey, sticking on gravity, I want to talk about gravity. So we know that gravity due to mass does not exist. And most flat earthers say it's buoyancy and density. And that's it. But then you have the ballers out there and even flat earthers like myself that go, but what says down? What makes it go down? And I think, Jay, you and I are on the same page here. We know that everything is electric. The Earth is electromagnetic in nature, and the Earth plane is electrified, and it has a static charge to it that basically just creates a down. It's a very weak force that just says, hey, this way is down, and it's like a television tube that attracts dust to it. You can actually do that experiment and you'll see, you know, dust particles get pulled right to the tube. And I think that the Earth does that, and then buoyancy and density sort everything out. It's that simple. And a butterfly can flap its wings and go away because the air is denser and it can push off of that, just like we can push off of water and swim through the water.
I totally agree. I think we've mentioned on the show before, I love how Bob on Globebusters always brings up the old static television, the old television screen that has the static electricity that causes the dust particles to be attracted to it. And I think that if you think of the surface of the Earth like that, where there is static electricity going through it, right? That is what keeps us all to the surface. And it's not like it's this huge sucking force. It's literally just establishing, that is what establishes, in my mind anyway, that is what establishes up and down direction. And then everything else, what goes up or what goes down, is determined by its density.
It's that simple.
Yeah. So, you know, and it's so easily explained. I mean, to me, that is such an example of Occam's razor. It's so simple.
And you can demonstrate it in a lab.
Yes, you can demonstrate that all day long. Everything is explained. It's so simple. It's so Occam's razor. Whereas on the other hand, you've got the spinning ball where you can't feel the spin, right? You can't see the curve, but it's there. Both of them are there. And as it relates to the gravity thing, again, it's the molten iron core that gives us the poles. And I mean, it's just so crazy. And yet science loves to throw out Occam's razor, and their stuff is always so much more complicated.
Matt, you said you did an experiment with gravity.
Yeah. I mean, so I did something called a Cavendish experiment, which is where you take a string, you know, tie it to the ceiling, for example, and then you tie it in the middle of a rod and then put two different weights on the side of the rod. And then you put large masses next to it. And I personally wanted to do something without metals involved because I'd seen them done a lot with different metals. And I wanted to make sure there was no magnetics playing into it. So I used a wood rod and put like heavy porcelain coffee mugs on either side. And use cinder blocks as my big masses. And I mean, I could create a scenario where if I put the cinder block on one side, it seemed like the coffee mug would attract towards the cinder block. And then I move it to the other and it seemed like it attract the other way. But I also noticed that, like, man, it's really hard to come up with a controlled environment where the air condition's not playing into, you know, the doors that open don't affect it. You walking by doesn't affect it. It's really tough to create, you know, for lack of a better word, frictionless vacuum, you know?
Well, Matt, did you,
can't you just do it in a vacuum?
Yeah. My question is, did you do it in your shed?
in my shed. I mean,
I think we found the problem.
did it in an office. And, you know, I mean, just.
Yeah, an office negates it. You have to do it in a shed.
Right.
That's the lab setting for the Cavendish experiment.
Right. Yeah. No, but you know, like it's the thing like, so let's just say, take, for example, a frictionless vacuum. Okay. If you take physics, every physics problem with regard to trajectory says in a frictionless vacuum, so-and-so shoots a rocket up at this angle, blah, blah, blah. And a frictionless vacuum is like the one place you can go to find, to see all the laws of gravity work perfectly. And it's also the one place you go where you can observe nothing that happens here on Earth all the time, right? So it's a place we can't go where all these mathematics work, but you can't observe anything like we observe just walking around on this plane.
I wonder if that's why they, well, I'm sure there's many reasons why they chose the vacuum for space. You know what I mean?
Sure.
I mean, it had to be, right?
I've also done what's called a Foucault pendulum. Mm-hmm. And with the Foucault pendulum, you say, you know, they say the thing rocks independent of the Earth, right? And the Earth spins underneath it, if anyone's familiar with that. But why isn't, they say you can observe the spin of the Earth, but the Earth is only spinning 1,000 miles an hour. The universe is expanding at 1,000,000 miles an hour. Why isn't it spinning independent of that? Why is it rocking back and forth independent of that?
And why is it that only a hanging pendulum can do something independent of the Earth itself, the surface of the Earth? Why? I mean, right. They tell us the planes, helicopters, everything else is part of the atmosphere, which is Velcroed and sticks to the Earth and rotates with it. But yet you hang something by a rope and it goes independent. I'm not buying that one bit.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure if you read Einstein, he talks about it being Velcroed.
Yes, for sure. Yeah, that's right. I think he used that exact terminology.
It's German, probably, but yeah, he said it.
I wanted to ask both of you your opinion really quick on this because we haven't covered this since it came out. Yanni or Laurel?
Laurel, 100%.
Laurel.
I've met some Yannis and I don't understand how it could be Yanni.
Can you guys hear that when I play that?
Yeah, we heard it.
Yeah.
All right, so
Laurel.
We're all hearing Laurel.
Laurel.
Correct.
Laurel.
And now I'm sure there's going to be listeners listening to this going, are you kidding me? That's Yanni. If you haven't heard this before, what is going on here?
Dave, you sent me this whenever it came out, but I hadn't been on the internet when this thing just blew up, right? And you sent it to me one morning and you said, check this out or whatever. And I played it and I'm like, well, it clearly says Laurel. And you said, no, just ask other people. The first two people I asked both said Yanni and it blew my mind. And I'm like you, man. I don't know. I don't think this is something very simple. I think this is huge for some reason. I feel in my gut this is a really big deal. Why are we all of a sudden, why is half the people seeing you remember the dress from a couple years ago?
Yep.
To this day, I've never looked at that dress and seen black and blue. I only see white and gold. Dave, you're the opposite. You've never seen the white and gold. Matt, what are you on the dress?
If I remember, I'm not white and gold. I believe I'm dark. But, you know, like, so today, so in Fort Worth, we've got the Colonial Golf Tournament, the 4th Invitational. And I got shunned by one of those guys that holds up the quiet please because I was playing the Yanni or Laurel deal. And I was, like, doing the high-pitched laugh. Like, I couldn't believe someone was Yanni, right? And everyone's looking at me, and I was wondering why. Well, someone's about to hit, right? I do think there's something bigger going on there. Like, I don't know if and I was with people that, you know, I was there for 20 minutes, which means we were already talking about Flat Earth, right? So it was and they were surprisingly open. These were like, stay-at-home moms that were open to the idea, you know?
What's the longest you've gone in a group and not brought up Flat Earth?
Well, here's the thing. Like, when you're, like, open about it on Facebook, it's the first thing anybody wants to talk about. They're like, hey, how's it going? Hey, tell me about this Flat Earth deal. It takes about 5 seconds.
All right, wow. Perfect. It was going around with my kids and all their friends. There was a group chat. And my son sends me this. Laurel versus Yanny is a government psyop. Do not vote on it, because you can go and you can vote on it online. The government is going to use the frequencies of this word we can't hear to start subliminally controlling our minds.
Hmm. I mean, I can't deny it.
I'm in. I buy it.
Yeah. Sold. Yeah, yeah. That wouldn't surprise me one bit. I just find it like absolutely insane that something as simple as this can be heard, you know, 50-50 by different people, something totally different. I mean, the words aren't even close to the same. Yanni's not even close to Laurel. A white and gold dress, going back to the Vision one, is not even close to a black and blue dress. And yet every explanation I would read on both those phenomenons, I don't buy any of it. I'm like, none of this makes sense. You know, if that's possible, what else is possible? Are people able to see things differently every day in life? Are people able to hear things differently?
It's like when I'm outside and there's heavy chemtrails going on, people don't see it. I think they're seeing fluffy clouds with bears and dolphins in them, and they don't see it. Or if I'm wearing a flat earth t-shirt, they don't see it until you force them to see it.
So I have a friend whose son has a dad who's a pilot, okay? And my friend got a text from her son saying, "Mom, look at the clouds. They're so weird." And they were the big puffy ones.
No way.
And I was like, that's what clouds are supposed to look like.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
Yeah. I will admit that I recently watched Better Call Saul and some of Breaking Bad. They're all those scenes, they're putting in chemtrails, like chemtrails. They make sure that there's chemtrails in the scene all the time. They're normalizing it. And hence that's what's happening. And Matt just proved it. Have you guys?
Well, either they're one of two things there, Dave. Either they're trying to normalize that, or I should say desensitize, or you've got somebody on there who's a quiet, you know, one of the creators who's a quiet chemtrail conspiracy believer, and is trying to like put it on the show to show people.
Well, that we could hope for that, but I don't think so. Have you guys seen the new one? Have you guys seen the new one? That's even stranger, Obama or Hillary? What do you hear? Yeah, listen carefully. I don't know how loud it is. What do you hear? Obama or Hillary? Ready? Here it goes.
Criminal. Criminal.
Oh, I can hear
it. I'm hearing both. I'm hearing Obama and Hillary.
Wow.
All I see is the Hillary face when the balloon started to drop. That's all I see.
Ouch. So when it comes to controversial topics, Dave, you told me a little bit about this earlier, and you said, ask me when we're recording and I'll explain. So just recently, IPS, former Flat Earth YouTuber, I think 2 weeks ago he said, "So people say I'm not a flat earther, and the truth is I'm not. I'm not a flat earther." And then apparently more recently than that, he's actually said he's a globe guy. And I said, "Hmm." And you said, "Let me give you my take while we're recording." So now, Dave, what is your take on IPS going to the globe?
IPS, Infinite Plane Society, he came onto the scene strong. He is very well spoken. He did that. He went to a town hall meeting and did, you know, brought up bubbles in space. Phenomenal. He started chat raids and things evolved from there. I was talking about doing a billboard for a year. I mentioned it to him 3 weeks later. A flat earth billboard's up in Philadelphia. He did a great job in all the stuff they did, but he caused so much controversy. There were so many people that hated him. Now, all of a sudden, he has left saying he was undercover. He's a glober. And he did it all to write a book on how he infiltrated the Flat Earth movement.
He admitted that he's undercover?
That he was undercover, and he's really a glober. And it was all about writing a book. And now his book's coming out. You know, he'll be doing a book. I think he's just a guy that woke up to Flat Earth. He didn't have a lot of money. He was trying to make it work. He was an amazing artist. He painted all those penguins. I actually got one and I love it. I love it. And now that it's just not working for him and he's going out to get a job, or maybe he's even writing a book, he's just saying that. He's just doing it for the controversy. There's no way with all of the points that he brought up, he was a great debater, that he could actually believe in the ball. There's no possible way. So I'm saying he's just doing it for the controversy, for an F you, and he's, that's why he's doing it. What do you think?
I don't know. Did he give, no, I guess not. I was about to say, did he give a reason he went back to the ball? But apparently no, it wasn't a true going back to the ball. He was undercover the whole time. He was never away from the ball.
It's a great story that hey, he was here undercover. He infiltrated. He got to know everybody. And you know what? I'll buy the book. Sounds like a great book to me.
Yeah. I don't know what to say. I don't know.
I'm not saying I like what he's doing. I'm just saying there's no way he went back to the ball. He's full of it. That's just what he's saying. He's doing it for the controversy. He's doing it to sell a book. Maybe even if his plan was to sell a book from day one, which I doubt it, he became a flat earther in the process.
Yeah, he sounded pretty flat earther to me, you know, back in the day. You know, it was about, what, 8-9 months ago or whatever when he was going strong. I mean, I was convinced that he was a flat earther. So I don't know. But he's definitely been a lightning rod for controversy. No doubt about that.
No doubt.
I don't know. Matt, do you have any thoughts on the IPS
stuff? I mean, I'm totally down with creating controversy to sell things. I mean, that's capitalism, right? You lost me at penguin paintings. I'm not sure what happened there.
You know what? He created, said penguins should be the flat earth mascot, or somebody said that and he grabbed onto it. I'm like, you know what? If you're going to have a mascot, penguins probably the best thing for it, because the whole Antarctica thing. And and then it was all about how he revolutionized live chats, where live chats had, you have a couple moderators in there. He made everyone a moderator. It's like, I say, you want to have a safe flight? Give everybody a taser. Every single person on the plane should have a taser or a gun. And then sure, it'll be the safest flight you ever had. No one's going to mess with anybody. So he created that. He started painting these penguins, holding the wrench. I love it. It's one of my favorite paintings.
Yeah, everything can be fixed on the ISS with a wrench, right?
Well, screw gun. That's true.
Right.
A Makita screw gun with a quarter inch socket.
Yeah, it's like every sci-fi movie out there, the climax is when they have to go outside to fix something, right?
Yep.
Wow. You know, I stumbled upon something the other day, another moon. You guys made me think of it when you said the wrench, but another Apollo mission deal that just blew my mind. So the rockets, the thrusters that were on the lunar module that brought the guys back from the moon up to rendezvous with the ship, right? Those rockets were, they were made a certain way, and the gases and it was some sort of helium in the gas, but they were so crazy that, like, when they fired up, they would melt everything around them. And therefore those things were never even tested. They were like loaded up, put on the lunar module, but they weren't even tested. I'm not saying they weren't tested in the right environment. Like, they were never tested for space. I'm saying the thrusters that brought them back to the ship were never even tested to see if they would work
ever.
Like, yeah. What are the chances of that? Like, seriously, like we're going to send guys up there. To me, that's unbelievable. That's like putting everyone on the first airplane ever, but never even testing the engines to see if they would crank up or not until you got us on the moon. That's BS. There's no way they would do that.
It doesn't matter because we didn't go. I was thinking about this the other day. When we launch a rocket or the space shuttle or the Soyuz or whatever it is that meets the international fake station, if it's a minute late, just a minute, the space station is 300 miles from where it should have been.
Wow.
And
true.
And how does it catch up? How does it make up that last, that 300 miles? Does it have to go to 24,000 miles an hour to break, to get out of orbit and then slow down to 17.5?
Yeah, that's a great question.
It's all such nonsense. And then has anyone measured how fast the hydrogen that they're burning is coming out of the engine? Is it going 17,000 miles an hour of thrust? I don't think that's even possible.
Oh, man. Yeah, there's so many things that they just never answer. How are they getting the data back to us from Mars or from the Juno deal that's out there in the middle of freaking the solar system? Is it just regular Wi-Fi? Is it internet? Is it radio frequency? I mean, how are they doing that? You know, how are they docking with the 17,500 mile space station? I mean,
they say that if two things are going 17,500 miles an hour together, they're not moving in comparison to each other. What about the guys moving around in the little capsule or even in the space station and pushing off the walls? Where does that energy go? Isn't that going to send the thing tumbling? Like if you're on a float in a pool and you roll over to one side of the float or something, the whole thing moves. If you're on a boat that's just perfectly still and you walk from one side of the boat to the other, the boat moves.
Yeah, there's a transferring of energy. Yeah.
Yeah. Like when they were chasing the gorilla through the gorilla mask, you know, the gorilla costume on the space station. Where did all of that force go? These guys running back and forth, bouncing off walls.
Obviously, you don't understand relativity.
And gravity and science, gyros.
Science, yeah, bro. Science,
what an idiot.
It's science, bro.
It's going 17,500 miles an hour, and you're only moving at like 2 miles an hour. What difference does that make?
Yeah.
You can just make up crap because that's what they do. They're laughing at us. Laughing.
Yeah, for sure. Jaren put out a sweet little video this week, Seeing Too Far. And I know that made you want to bring something up, Dave, about seeing too far.
People don't realize that things get smaller and smaller in the distance very quickly to the point where their angular size is too small for our eyes to see. But when you have a giant mountain that's, let's say it's 150 miles away and its angular size should be plenty big to see, but you can't see it. The reason you can't see it is because of the light that's reflecting off of it can't make it 150 miles back to your eyes because there's too much stuff in the way. That's like the Canigou Peak in France that you can see from 135 miles on a couple days of the year. The only reason you can see it is because the sun is setting behind it and the sunlight is way more powerful and can travel farther than reflected light. And you're seeing the silhouette of the mountain. You're not seeing the mountain. You're seeing the mountain blocking the sun.
Hmm.
And the fact that you can see that proves that the earth is flat. I mean, there's nothing else you need. We can see too far.
Yeah, Jaren had a very interesting PDF that he brought up in that video dealing with Antarctica, where it was one of the government documents or whatever, where they talk about the fact that the air is so clear at times where you can see a boat that looks like it's 3 miles away, but it's actually like 35 miles away. Like it can play tricks on your eyes. And it's said that many have seen a mountain, which is actually 300 miles away.
And the reason the air is so clear is because it's cold. There's no humidity there. There's no pollution. It's more humidity. It's more moisture in the air that blocks your vision, that bends the light from even getting to you or blocks it. So yeah, that makes perfect sense that you can see too far in Antarctica.
I didn't see Jaren's video. That sounds awesome. I need to look it up. But I've got a buddy who I work with who talked about it was a skydiving incident in Antarctica with some expert skydivers that ended up, I want to say like half of them ended up dying because of the, they weren't used to jumping in such thin atmosphere and their instruments weren't working the proper way. And I forget what year it was, but if you look up a skydiving accident, Antarctica, it'll pop up. And it's a super interesting read, about a 10 or 15 minute read. It was something unrelated to flat earth, but the guy knows I'm a flat earther, so he brought it up to me. Definitely a thinner atmosphere there. Two or three people of four or six people ended up dying that were professional skydivers that weren't prepared for that type of atmosphere.
Yep. I was just Googling it as you were saying it, Matt. And
what do you mean?
A good bit of information on
it. It doesn't relate to flat earth. everything relates to flat Earth.
Well, yeah,
everything.
right. Yeah. So,
what kind of cereal did you have this morning? Flat Earth. Period.
Frosted flat Earth.
I don't need breakfast. Bald Earth is your breakfast.
We could see too far.
Where is the curvature?
Yeah.
Where? No curvature.
There you go.
Exactly. Yeah, they call it the worst civilian skydiving accident in 30 years. It was in 1997. Wow.
Is that real? Or are they just trying to stop people from wanting to skydive in Antarctica and seeing too far?
Great question. Like, I've never gone to walk Antarctica, so the likelihood that I would ever go skydive there is probably thin. It's interesting when you think about, you know, how high could the plane go compared to normal? You know, these people were not just like novice skydivers. If you read that article, I mean, they were all very skilled, had done a bunch of jumps, that it was because of the thinness of the air, the coldness of the air, and a couple other things. It's been a couple months since I've read the article. A couple of people end up just never pulling their chute, essentially.
And I think it's probably a combination of the both things, Dave. I think it was probably real, and it was probably heavily publicized because you never let a good crisis go to waste, right?
There you go. Exactly. Just like the Concorde stopped flying because of a horrible crash. Many people believe that was just a staged event to take the Concorde out of commission because people looking out the window on the Concorde were seeing too far.
You know, something interesting about that, Dave, like I've got a buddy who's a pilot and he does like private flights. Okay. And so they fly higher than your commercial airliners. Commercial airliners, what is it, like 40,000 feet, 30,000 feet, something like that. These guys fly around 50,000 feet, but they are not allowed to fly any higher. Like they're regulated. They're not allowed to go any higher than that. And this guy sends me videos all the time. It's just interesting that they're not allowed to go any higher. I'm not sure what their aircraft is rated to go to.
Somebody made a video the other day and they were talking about the Concorde. And I've heard this before, that they tell you to shut the window shades at certain times during the flight because they're passing the sun. They say we're passing the sun.
Weird.
Yeah. So the sun was at the level of the windows shining right in. Now, Baller would say, well, that's because the Earth is tilting, you know, and the sun's at every level, you know, it happens everywhere. But we're passing the sun, and I just picture it like when we see the sun on a balloon, it looks like it's right there, not over it, just off to the side.
I would think, anyway, the height difference between a Concorde and a regular commercial airliner wouldn't necessitate that you close windows on a Concorde. Like if it was just the ball Earth, you follow me? If it was just a normal sun coming around the ball Earth, like no one's ever heard that on a plane. Hey, put your windows down because we're going right next to the sun.
Yeah, right now you're only 92.99 million miles away.
Exactly. The extra, you know, 15,000 feet up are not going to necessitate everyone closing the windows. And I'll tell you this, knowing everything we know now, if a pilot ever gets on the intercom and says, hey, everybody close their windows, that's the last thing I'm doing. My window is staying open.
Absolutely. I wanted to mention this before when you and I talked about this a little while ago, the crepuscular rays on the sun. So everybody knows what crepuscular rays are, where they splay out from the sun. And it basically, if you triangulate them back, it appears that the sun is right above the cloud. And you can see them going in all directions, to the left, to the right, towards you and away from you. When the conditions are right and the sun, if you wait for the sun to rise, come over the horizon, become visible. I've seen it where you can see those rays shooting in all directions around the sun. If the sun were 93 million miles away and was just coming up over the horizon, you wouldn't see that. You would see rays coming directly towards you only. You wouldn't be able to see the rays that are shooting down from the sun or from the back or to the left and to the right of the sun. You would only see the ones coming at you. And it's because when we see the sun, it's right over the Earth plane. And if you zoom in on it with your camera or binoculars, you can see those rays going in all directions around.
Yeah, it took me a second when you mentioned that earlier to get my head around it, but I think I follow you. If it's that, if it's 93 million miles away, the ones on the bottom especially are not going to, you're not going to see them hitting the Earth.
Right, and the ones off the back side of it. Imagine you have a table in a room and you put some smoke in the room and you have a flashlight. You put the flashlight over the table and you can see the rays shooting down in a cone shape and you move it away and then you go past the edge of the table and bring it all the way across the room. You're not going to see those rays that are shooting away from you. you're only going to see the light that's coming towards you. It's a hard one to wrap your mind around, but it makes perfect sense on a flat plane with a close small sun.
Wow.
Something to think about. Rory Cooper has done some videos on it. One of his recent ones did talk about that, and that's why I've been thinking about it. And I did witness the sun setting in that situation. We had a really clear day over the water, and I could see the rays going all in both directions, all the way around.
I don't know if we've done it enough on this show, on this podcast in general, but hats off to Rory, who's got the My Perspective channel, because when it comes to like breaking things down visually, dude, his channel is second to none.
Yep. Great stuff.
I don't know what program he uses or what software he's using for that, but it is incredible. And if you ever needed to visualize some things, like some of the stuff that we're talking about on the podcast, that's hard to explain over there, check out My Perspective's channel, because it is incredible what he shows. I've always thought that.
I made a video last week. Somebody had done the test. Remember, Rob Skiba had done the sun setting with the magnification?
Oh, yeah.
As he moves it away, it sets. But as it shrinks in due to perspective, it's magnified at the same time. So it basically stays the same size.
It's a wash.
Yeah. So somebody did it with a candle and the same thing. And I took that little piece and made it, you know, put it together and zoomed in on it a little bit, made it easier to see. To me, it really takes the argument, the sun doesn't shrink, therefore the earth isn't flat. Well, it shrinks and grows at the same time. It's a perfect balance. Sometimes on a dry, clear day, the sun does shrink.
Yeah.
If you're higher up, the sun does shrink.
Yeah, the videos where they're shooting up higher in the mountains and it's in a dry area, those videos are unbelievable as far as it's right. Just so obvious that the sun is shrinking, and it's so obvious when you see it that it is going away from you, not setting downward.
Did you see the sunset video I did with the drone recently where it was super clear and the sun went away and away and away? And then before it disappeared, before it shrunk to nothing or got eclipsed, it just faded out. It soaked into the sky.
That was unbelievable.
Yeah. Yeah. It's incredible.
But from the ground, you saw the sunset, you saw it get eclipsed by a cloud horizon. But I was high enough where I didn't have that perspective. There was no land features that were higher than my eye level in the distance.
How high were you?
I was 300 meters. 300 meters. But the problem is, from where I am, you know, if I'm over the treetops, if the clouds don't eat it, a couple hundred miles away, there's some mountains, and the mountains will eclipse it because the mountains are over my eye line.
Well, and two, but it's not something you're even going to notice a difference unless you're documenting it.
That's like when you see a car down the street, you don't see a tiny car. Your brain sees it as the same size car as you've always seen.
Right.
So I wanted to bring something up a second ago whenever Matt, you mentioned the fact that like to go over the certain height or whatever, it's regulated. Like you have to have permission. You can't do it. FAA or whatever. So a couple of weeks ago, we got an email from someone, and I forgive me because it's not in front of me. I don't know the name of the person, but he had a great two sentence email. He says, it seems to me like the perfect test would be to send up a balloon with a camera attached at night, you know, at midnight or whatever. If we see the sun in our camera shot, it's game over for the ball. And I got to thinking about that. I asked Dave, I'm like, wait a minute, you know, could it be that easy? Because we've seen all that high altitude balloon footage where we see the sun and the moon off in the not so distant distance. And he's right. If we got a balloon up there and we launched it at midnight from anywhere on Earth, doesn't matter where it's at. If it's midnight, there is no chance in the world that we should ever, ever, ever see the sun.
Not even a superior mirage.
No, yeah, right. That'd be one superior. That'd be one. Geez, that'd be one superior mirage. But I asked Jaron about it. I said, Jaron, I said, could it be that simple? Is there any way to debunk it if we launch something at night? Is there anything they could say to debunk that as far as like why we would see the sun or whatever? And he goes, no, I can't think of a single thing you could argue. And I said, well, what does it take to get a balloon up at night? And he said, well, you do have to get FAA permission for a balloon launch at night.
Dan Dimensions does it all the time.
Does he do the night launches?
Yeah, amazing ones where sunset, sunrise, at night. If anybody really wants to see how day and night works, Dan Dimensions is his channel. All of his videos are fantastic. I've taken pieces of them and used them in some of mine.
So That makes me ask the question, because I have seen some of his launches and stuff. Has he ever launched at night and gotten footage of the sun? Because it seems like if that's the case, maybe we've missed the obvious.
There are some where it is nighttime below the balloon and you can see the sun. So I don't know when he launched.
Yeah, because again, if it's midnight, anytime between 11 and 2 a.m. and you're only 100,000 feet off the ball, there's no way on earth you would be able to see around the ball to catch that sun.
True.
It's the opposite side of the earth, for God's sakes.
True. Getting back to the sun setting and getting smaller, think about this, and I don't know if I can even describe it properly. If the sun is very close, the higher it is, the higher the apparent perspective arch it would make. So picture the sun is above you, 12 o'clock. As it moves away, you're going to see it going down. But for every X, number of miles it goes, it drops, let's say, half of the distance. Doesn't matter what the number is. It drops half the distance. And then the same amount of time, it drops half of whatever distance is left to the horizon. And then the same amount of time, it drops half of that distance. So it's never going to go below the horizon. But you have this arch. And that arch is your day, sunrise to sunset. Once it makes that arch, you're not going to even notice the drop anymore. And that's when it shrinks. But it's usually cut off by then by either land features or atmospheric blocking. So you're going to see the sun rise quickly, go overhead quickly, set quickly. And then when it gets down to where each time you half that, you're not going to notice a difference because it's right at the horizon. That's when you see the sun move away and shrink into nothing. But the conditions have to be super clear. 32 degrees, so there's no humidity, and you have to be at altitude, and you have to be looking, and you have to be filming, and that doesn't happen a lot. That's why people don't see it.
Yeah, you just blew my mind again.
Did I explain that?
No, yeah, you did. You did. It just blew my mind, though.
That's how it works. So it stays the same size in that arch over you. You've seen the tennis ball experiment where you have a camera on the ground, and you have a tennis ball, and you roll it across the room, and it shrinks?
Yes.
Then you look at the camera, you point up at a tennis ball on the ceiling and you move that across the same distance and it stays the same size. That's what's happening with the sun from just a little after sunrise to just the very end of sunset. It's basically you already have that distance, but then because you're not seeing it get any lower because it's already the angular resolution of the difference of its height of it to the ground from perspective is insignificant. You can't see the difference. The sun will just fade away. But 99 out of 100 times, it gets blocked and it looks like it's setting.
Wow. I think I need Rory to do a video on that.
There you go.
Rory, if you're listening to the podcast, that's our next request.
Speaking of requests, well, we once requested Freddie Flintoff, the cricket player, who was talking flat earth, to come on the show. And since then, Freddie has done a commercial. What was the commercial for?
It was some contest, like some star contest or something or another.
Where they shot him into space and it made sure to show the curve of the earth. It was just a mind programming ball earth heliocentric commercial.
Well, Freddie might have needed the endorsements, Dave.
Yeah, you know what I would
say,
do it.
Come on. He didn't say the earth isn't flat. He just did a space commercial, you know?
Hey, we've been going for about an hour. You want to do some speak pipes?
Yeah, I was about to say, Matt can be on the other side of the speak pipeness.
Matt, you want to stay and listen to a couple of speak pipes with us?
Yeah, of course. I got time.
All right.
And before we go, I want to point out on our website, we now have a link to the Denver conference. And if you want to buy tickets, come to theflatearthpodcast.com. When you go to buy your tickets, you can buy them through us or go through the other way. If you use the code FE podcast, all one word, FE for flat earth, FE podcast, you get a 10% discount on your tickets.
Nice. Nice.
Would love to see every listener there. If you're a baller, come. I'll buy you lunch. If you're a baller and you take the 10% discount, I'll buy you lunch when you're there. All right. We want ballers there because we have enough flat earthers going already.
So you get 10% off and a lunch. Bam.
And a lunch. Yeah, there you go. But you have to come to me and you have to use the podcast, the code FE podcast.
The Flat Earth Podcast.
You want to leave a digital voicemail for us? Head over to theflatearthpodcast.com and Click on the blue link that reads, got a question? Send us a message.
You can do it from your iPhone or from your computer. First time you do it on your cellular phone, you'll have to download a little app. But after that, you can leave us all kinds of messages. If you want to be anonymous, you can make up a name, make up an email address. We don't care. We just want to hear what you have to say.
We'll do our best to play or answer these questions and comments on future episodes right here on the Flat Earth Podcast. Download the SpeakPipe app. And check us out at theflatearthpodcast.com.
The Flat Earth Podcast.
If you're watching this audio on YouTube right now, and you're not familiar with the world of podcasting, there's a far better way to listen to the Flat Earth Podcast each and every week.
Think of it like your TiVo or your DVR is to your television. You subscribe to whatever show that you like. Whenever a new episode comes out, it records it, downloads it, and notifies you that there's a new episode for easy listening anywhere. Another great feature on most podcast players is you could speed up if you want to hear stuff even faster, or more importantly, it has a jump back and jump forward 30 seconds so you could skip annoying announcements like this.
We're on iTunes, Stitcher, SoundCloud, and so many more. If we're not on your favorite podcast app, send us a message and let us know to make sure we will be.
The Flat Earth Podcast.
All right, back with us here on the Flat Earth Podcast. Let's take some speak pipes. This first one is from Kate.
Hi, guys. I just wanted to say thank you so much for your show. I really enjoy listening to you guys. My name is Kate, and I started my Flat Earth journey about 8 months ago. And, you know, it really wasn't that far of a stretch for me to believe in Flat Earth over Ball Earth, because as a Christian, I do believe that Satan roams the earth and seeks to steal, kill, and destroy. And so for him to pull off a deception on this kind of scale, it wasn't too far of a stretch for me to believe that. But the thing that I am kind of hung up on now is that I am a homeschooling mom, and my kids are still in the preschool years. So it's not a huge thing that I need to think about right now, but I am sort of thinking, like, how am I going to approach this topic with my kids? Do you guys have any suggestions? Thank you.
Thank you, Kate, for that. And I think that's an incredible question. And I've asked that same question to others on this show before. I personally have children, and I want to get Matt and Dave, I want to get your take on this. But for me personally, the one thing that we've tried to do with our kids who are roughly the same age, kindergarten, first, second grade, what we've tried to do is instill the whole, put a little wiggle room in their minds. In other words, every time they start quoting the stuff with science, because they start coming home and regurgitating this stuff, and it's like we mentioned earlier in the show, it drives me nuts. But the one thing that we try to put in their heads is that's what science thinks. You know, even so much so when my little boys were talking about the astronauts on the moon one night, and I said, well, that's what they think. You know, that's what they think. And my daughter looked at me like I was nuts. And I was like, yeah, well, you know, maybe they did, maybe they didn't, but that's what they think. That's what science thinks. So you always got to put that in that little room for doubt without giving them information that just totally opposes what their teachers are telling them, because we can't do that. We can't arm them with the truth in first grade. They're not ready to defend themselves. That's the only thing we can do at this point, is just try to put a little bit of doubt in there and just say, well, that's what science thinks. Dave, Matt, I'm open to anything you guys got when it comes to what can we do about the little children.
Sure. Yeah. So just like you, Jay, I've got a girl. She's six. She's wrapping up kindergarten, and she's super pumped about graduating kindergarten, by the way. So she'll be.
That's awesome.
But yeah, just like you, like I've allowed her to have that wiggle room where I've asked her questions. Just like Kate, I come from a biblical mindset, and kind of the first big lie is the millions and billions of years, at least from the biblical point of view, which is the point of view I hold. And so Landon, which is my little girl, will be watching something and we'll see something, and they talk about millions or billions of years, and she'll look at me and smirk and go, that's not real, you know? And so that was the first step, and that was before we even got into Flat Earth. Now we see things on outer space, and she is totally clued in on what is a picture and what is computer generated.
Good.
And so I don't tell her, hey, the earth is flat, but I say, look, you need to make up your own mind. And in fact, she's told me she thinks the earth is a ball, okay? Because, not because she's seen it, but because that's what her teachers have told her. But at least she, and she's only six, but at least she's thinking period, right? I mean, she's not just absorbing. And so, you know, and you guys talk about it all the time, but schools nowadays teach you what to think, not how to think. And I'm trying to teach her how to think.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jay, I like your answer. I would do it a little differently. I would have the kid, when he's in class and the teacher said something, to stand up, point at the teacher and say, "You're a liar or an idiot.
You're a shill.
You're a liar or you're uninformed and you're stupid."
Right.
And that's it. And I just think, you know.
Yeah, pretty much the same answer, just a little different. Yeah.
Okay. Basically, have you seen that Kevin Hart? "My mama told me to tell you."
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly. Now, I will say this, Kate. There's one other thing I forgot to mention in my answer, which I did a couple years ago. And that is I've got an office, dare I say, man cave area in the house, right? And in there, I made sure that I've put several of the famous flat earth maps up on the wall. And I've never told the kids what it is or why it's there, but I specifically put it up in a room where they come down, because they come down in this room a lot to play, and I'll put it right in their little play area. And that is only because I'll explain it one day if they ever ask. But the reason I did it was because I didn't want one day, 10 years from now, 5 years from now, 20 years from now, when someone does introduce this flat earth concept to them, I didn't want it to be as foreign as of a concept as it was when I first heard it. I'm like, wait, what? Flat disc? Wait, what? So I just wanted it to kind of like subliminally be in the back of their minds as another option visually in their brain for earth. So that was the other thing I've specifically did for the kids.
Just to elaborate on that, like, my daughter knows what I believe. Like, there's no getting around it. Like, she knows what her dad believes because I've been man enough to tell her. And whether, you know, obviously I think that I'm right, but whether I'm right or wrong, like, she knows what her dad believes. And I think there's a lot of power in that, you know?
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
So what I hear you saying, Matt, is you're calling Jay a pussy.
No. No.
Yeah, right.
Jay's probably done the exact same thing. All I'm saying is, unlike Dave, who's a concave earther, my daughter knows I'm a flat earther.
My girlfriend's daughter is home from college for the summer, and all of her friends are gathering all the time. And she had a little party the other night, and I was upstairs. She brought up about six people, four guys and two girls, that said, "We want to talk to you about flat earth." And one of them was a astrophysics major.
Oh no.
And I was just like, "You're wasting your money, buddy." The indoctrination is as strong as it was when you're in kindergarten. So it went well with some of them. Were like, "Wow, I never really thought of that. You know what? I don't know if the earth is flat or a ball." And I said, "Perfect. Cause if you think it's a ball, a flat, because of this 5 minute conversation, you're crazy as the people that think it's a ball." In general, they have this little cave where they hang out. We have a cool downstairs. And I just today on the coffee table left my flat earth book.
Mm-hmm.
So now when they come, they have this book that's going to be staring at them. And anybody that picks up that book is ruined for life.
Well, as you know, the more schooling somebody has, the more indoctrinated they are. And I posted a video recently on Flat Earth on Facebook, and someone's response was, what level of astronomy did you take? And I wrote back, "College," but the person who invented the Big Bang was a priest. So
yeah, it's a good point. It's amazing how those things overlap, right? When you really look into it. Yeah. So great question, Kate. Hopefully we helped a little bit. It was great to have Matt on. Because we've touched on that subject before. It's been a long time since we touched on the flat earth for kids subject. But so it was great to have another point of view on there. Let's go to another call. This is from, I believe, from Jeffrey.
"Hello, this is Jeffrey. I just wanted to let you guys know gold is sold by mass, not by weight. Weight changes as you go from the equator to the North Pole, for instance, or many other places. If you get on a plane, your weight changes. Mass does not change. Mass, you can use a balance. Weight, you use a spring."
Got it.
Yeah, you idiot.
We addressed it earlier. Thank you, Jeffrey. We do appreciate that. And we addressed it earlier. So basically, the old worth is weight in gold is an incorrect saying, right?
Right. It should be worth its mass in gold.
Worth its mass in gold. All right. Exactly. All right. Let's go to this next one from Diego.
Hey, I sent a speak pipe on the last episode about the school project for Flat Earth, and it looks like I'm going to be going through and doing a bit of a debate or project with someone. So they're going to be taking the debunking Flat Earth, and I'm going to be taking going for Flat Earth. I was wondering if I had, I have three main topic points for my argument, and I was wondering what three would you recommend to use. I have some ideas, like the curvature, it's pretty irrefutable, but I was wondering if there's any other things that are like that come to mind. I've got a lot going on with school. I was wondering, this should be pretty obvious, like since you guys have been doing this for a while, so if you could let me know, that'd be great. But I'm definitely gonna do more research and wish me luck on the debate. But thanks for doing the podcast. So I'll talk to you guys later.
Right. Thank you, Diego. Okay. So good question. If he's got to break it down into three points, I think we'll probably have some overlap here in our answers, guys, but let's everyone give your three. Matt, you want to start?
Sure. So obviously curvature is a big one for a lot of people, including myself. The Bible is a big one, and just all ancient cultures across the world, like they literally had to be told they were on a spinning ball because they didn't see it that way. Okay. And then the other one would be our everyday experience. If you don't take information from anybody else, what would you say is happening here? If you were to stand still, say you had no programming coming in from anywhere, what would you say it was? And have you ever seen the Earth from space? And the answer is obviously no. You haven't seen the Earth from space. So what? Anyway, that's me. Don't get me off on my deal. So,
Dave, what's your three?
We can see too far. There's no curvature. You can talk about airplanes, how they fly, and don't have to nose down. And every single observation we have, I guess a big one would be the stars. Is 6 months apart, you can still see many of the same stars where you shouldn't be able to see any of the same stars.
I love that one.
Yeah, I like that one too. I would probably go very similar to you guys. It goes very simple. I would say lack of measurable curvature is my first topic, obviously. And I would include in that, I would sneak Dave's we see too far into that topic. So I would say that nowhere on Earth can we ever measure curvature. In fact, what we actually can measure is the absence of curvature by being able to see too far. And I would hammer that home. No curvature, no curvature. We see too far. It's never been observed. The second thing I would go with is water is always level. And with your human eyes, no matter how high you've gotten, you've never seen settled water bend ever. And yet 70% of our planet is supposedly made up of it. And the third thing I would do, I would cheat, and I would say, not cheat, but I would take a little detour, and I would just, in my third point, I would crucify NASA. My third point would be NASA are proven liars.
Right.
And I would go into green screen. I would tell them the Google bubbles in space. I would tell them about all our ISS problems. And I would just load them up with NASA is garbage.
Pictures of Earth is another one.
Yeah. Pictures of Earth, I would include in that.
I love when people go, what about all the pictures of Earth? I'm like, can you show me two?
Right.
Show me one. When they like, well, there's tons. I show them the picture, the eight pictures of Earth. Which one do you like? You know, not, they're all different colors, different shapes, different everything.
Yes.
To Jay's point, I mean, a ball is defined by curve, right? And if you can prove that there's no curve, you're not on a ball. There's a guy, his name's Jared Kressman. He's got a show, Through the Black, on YouTube. I mean, he says all the time that NASA was started by Freemasons, Nazis, and magicians, right? And that's a tough start right there, you know, if you're going to go for someone you can listen to.
Yeah, that's right. In a flat earth debate / discussion in class like that, I would definitely use up one of my three points with NASA, because it's everyone's, you know, go-to. And when you can establish water doesn't bend, there is no measurable curvature, and we can see too far. And then you follow it up with the only time you've ever seen water curve or curvature at all is via one organization, NASA. And now let's talk about them. And you crucify them, boom, it leaves them pretty, it leaves them with a lot to defend anyway.
Yeah. Oh, by the way, it says sex in the clouds.
Yeah, of course. Totally natural.
Totally natural.
All right. So, yeah, great question and good luck with that, Diego. Let's go to this one from Chris.
Hey, Dave. Just had a quick question about blood over intent. They're saying to I don't know if you've seen it on YouTube. You spill your blood over a sheet of paper that says I'm here to bring heaven on earth. It's in the middle of the flat earth, and they say it's the gate for gateway to Shambhala. Just give me your thoughts on that. Thanks. Bye.
Right. Obviously, I guess referring to the videos from Devin Maggi, I believe is his name.
Yes.
Yes. Dave, what's your thoughts on the blood over intent?
So here's what I'll say about blood over intent is blood is not what they tell us it is. Blood is a powerful substance. It is something the elite are obsessed with. I mean, if you look into the practices that they've been accused of, it's horrifying. So our words and our thoughts create things. We create our reality, and that's why the elite are trying to control how we think, to keep us believing we're on a spinning ball, random speck in the universe without a creator or anything, takes away our power. And the elite are trying to control our thoughts in all kinds of ways. So getting back to the blood, if you put your intent and spill blood on it, that's some kind of magic that may be happening. So if they're using it for evil or good or whatever, can it be used for good? I don't know. How's that for an answer?
Are you spilling your blood over intent there,
that's
over there, Dave?
A very personal question there.
I'm just curious.
I may have written down some positive statements and put a couple thumbprints on it. There are things that we just really don't even have the words to describe, and this is up there.
Yeah, yeah. My take on it is I don't really understand it, and so often when I'm watching a video and they get into something that I don't understand, it kind of I just kind of glaze over and I tune out. So in no way would I say, oh, that silly magic stuff doesn't work. I don't know anything. You know, I'm just saying I don't know.
Whether you believe it or not, the elite believe it. The elite practice it all the time.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
there's something to it. Some people say, well, it's evil. Well, is it evil or just evil people know about it?
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Is the thing itself evil or is it just evil people doing what they want with it? Yeah. I don't know. All right. Matt, you got any thoughts on that before I take the next one?
Just from a spiritual mindset, I mean, the blood is a powerful thing, especially, I mean, you just go, you know, you think about the blood sacrifices, you know, from a biblical standpoint, Old Testament, when Cain killed Abel, God said that Abel's blood cried out to him. Okay. I mean, there are literal vampires out there. Look up a guy named William Schnoblin on YouTube with One Accord. I mean, he's got some incredible stuff there. And like Dave said, whether you believe in it or not, they are using these things to, they think that they're growing their powers. Okay.
Right.
And it's, if you don't have a good versus evil mindset, I mean, there's some weird freaky stuff out there, no doubt.
Sure. I won't argue with that. All right. This next one is from John.
Hiya, John here. I really enjoy your podcast. I'm not a flat earther yet. I'm about 50-50. Even if I find something that does prove the globe, I've really enjoyed looking into this. But anyway, my question doesn't prove anything either way. I was just wondering if anyone's explained yet what could cause a leap year on a flat earth model. Why would they have had to account for a leap year if the earth was flat? It's been explained for a globe. I was just wondering if anyone's explained that yet. Thank you.
Great question, John. And thank you for the call. So Dave, do you know the answer to this one? The leap year on the flat earth?
First, his question is that even if he finds something that proves the globe, he had a good time looking into this. Well, you're not going to find anything. There is nothing. Good. What's your explanation? Because
mine's going to be terrible. But I remember watching a video and understanding it, but not so sure I could repeat it. But it has to do with the sidereal year over the flat Earth, the rotation of the stars being a different speed than the sun. And I want to say it was P-Brain that might have done a great video on this, and he explained the sidereal year, the 365, and the leap year with the rotation of the stars just being at a different speed than the sun going around.
They've hijacked our calendar from us. The solstices aren't when they tell us they are.
At one point when I watched one of these videos that explained it, I understood the answer. I just can't repeat it. But it was very much the same in the fact that, you know, the sun is going around at a certain speed. The stars are rotating at a certain speed. And therefore, you're losing 4 minutes a day or whatever. I mean, it was the exact same reason as the globe.
Or the sun cycles from Cancer to Capricorn and back in 300 and it just like a quarter.
64 days.
Yeah, 64.75 days to do that. So every 4 years, there's an extra day in there. That's it.
Yeah. And that's what I'm getting at is like it was the exact same answer as the globe.
Same as the globe. Right.
Right. It just has to do with the speed of the stars and the sun going over the Earth. That was it. Very good question. And I guess we'll brush up on that and try to get you some more information, Matt, unless you got a good answer for that one.
To me, it's the same on the globe or the flat Earth. It's just a matter of reconciling the extra time.
Right, right. All right. This one is from, I believe, Scott here. Let's check this one out.
Hey, guys. My name is M. Scott Beach. I am a baller. I'm a big fan of the podcast. I guess, you know, I guess a lot of ballers are, which is pretty cool. Although I have to admit, you guys do infuriate me quite a lot, but in a good way, I think. Anyway, I think you guys do a great job, and I dig it. I guess you guys do have a particularly harsh view, I think, of people who believe the ball. And I think you paint us with too broad of a brush. So many times I've heard you talk about how we just believe what we're told from people in white coats and how we don't really understand stuff. And a lot of that stuff is just not true. And I just feel like you guys have closed yourself off so much to hearing our explanations or hearing what we know that I think it's doing you a disservice. Even if you guys are ultimately right, I think it's doing you a disservice. That, however, is not why I am calling. I just want to actually let Jay know that I love his get-rich-quick scheme. Arbitraging gold sounds fun. Unfortunately, you buy and sell gold by mass, not by weight. So a mass is invariant. It won't matter where you are in the world. It'll cost and sell the same.
All right. Great call. Now, I don't know about you guys, but I really appreciate some of the ballers calling in with comments like that and listening to the show. I don't necessarily have a negative view to a lot of the ballers. And I think we said earlier in the show, I understand it. Dave or Matt, do you guys want to respond to that? Because I do want to make another statement about that, but go ahead, guys.
Yeah, so like one, I don't understand why we infuriate anybody, okay? that was a great speak pipe. Like the guy said, nice, totally get it. Like,
yes,
the reason we don't tolerate those is because we've looked into it and we don't buy it.
That's what I was going to say.
It's not that we're not listening. It's that we've researched, and I'll put out a video, for example, and I'll state what science says, and then I'll say, I don't believe it. And then I'll get comment after comment of no, you don't understand because, you know, all these things that, you know, science says. And I'm like, look, I just stated that. All I said was I didn't believe it. Why are you pissed off and writing in all caps? And I guess I did kind of lump them all in right there. Maybe they need to get a hold of maybe they need to start a ballers podcast. You know, at some point there'll be enough flat earthers. Well, there'll have to be a ball earth podcast. Right.
And right.
They can all, I don't see too many pissed off.
What would they talk about, Matt? What would they talk about?
Yeah. I like what you said, Matt, because that's what I wanted to mention too. When I heard him say that, I am fully aware. I think all of us are. I'm fully aware that science has an answer for all of our questions. And in fact, it took me a year and a half at least. I've literally looked every answer up to every question I had. So my problem with the heliocentric model is not that we've got all these questions you don't have answers for. In fact, you've got answers for them. My problem is with the answers. And that's what I've tried to point out on this show so many times. It's like, you know, it's like, okay, so the difference between, use this because it's the easiest example of all. We say it almost every episode. In the summertime, we're 1.5 million miles further from the sun than we are winter. And so how is it hotter, right? Well, science, I know your answer. It's because of the 23.5 degree tilt. And because the rays are coming in at a certain angle and that heats us up better. And I'm saying, I know your answer. And that's what I challenge. That's what I don't accept. Show me the scientific experiment that backs that up. And almost every question ends up the same way. So here's my question. I know your answer. I've looked it up. But I don't see one single experiment, one single proof, one single way to demonstrate these answers. And that's the problem I have.
Jumping back a little bit to it kind of relates to this. We were talking about different experiments, and I wanted to bring up Eratosthenes. That's what ballers throw at us all the time. What about Eratosthenes? He did this test. Well, think about this. Eratosthenes had to go out and look up at the sun and go, oh yeah, all of those rays are hitting the earth parallel no matter where you are, right? How could anyone look at the sun and think such a thing? Anytime you look at the sun, the rays are going out, they're splaying out like a cone.
Yeah, no, I agree. How did he make the assumption that it was millions of miles away?
How did he make the assumption that they were coming in parallel when they never do?
Well, it's like...
They never do.
You're right. It's same thing with everyone's big... they knew that it was... they knew the Earth was round because the lunar eclipse, the Earth casts its shadow and it's round. It's not a square. It's not a disc. It's round. What else could cause... But that's making a very large assumption that the Earth was in fact causing that shadow.
Right, yeah, just because there is a explanation doesn't mean it's the explanation.
Then they mix that explanation. Well, if the Earth was a disc, it would make a line on the, because if it was turned sideways, only a sphere, no matter what angle it's at, causes the same shadow. And that's the dumbest argument ever, but people just buy it. They're like, oh yeah, it couldn't be a disc. Well, you're right, it isn't a disc. We don't live on a disc.
Sure, I mean, like, yes, it's a fact. People believe in a flat earth. And then the second part is that people take things that people that believe in a flat earth don't believe in to prove the flat earth doesn't exist, right?
Correct.
Yeah. And look, I'll concede. I try not to use the baller glober terms negatively because we were all there. I mean, I try anyway. You know, I think derogatory thoughts about trolls, all right? The guys who are just trolling and getting on, you know, there's a big difference. But as far as like the people who are still believing in the globe, still hanging on, I don't necessarily have bad thoughts. And I'll just say it out loud. I apologize if I've ever painted a whole group of globe believers with one brush, because that's not fair.
I totally agree with it.
It happens to us all the time. They say flat earthers think the sun, you know, say the sun is 3,000 miles away. Well, that's not all of us. Yeah, that's not many of us anymore.
I totally agree with that, Jay, right. And I want to apologize too if I've ever generally painted that. But yeah, the attitude is really geared towards trolls. And if anybody is guilty of not remembering what it was like to not be a baller, to not be a flat earther, it's Dave, right? He kicked people off the show, right? Wouldn't even listen to him. Now he thinks they're all idiots. Come on, Dave.
That's true.
Yeah, we all came from that side, but we really appreciate you listening. I encourage anybody who's out there who's a Glober and that listens to our show not to troll us. I think that's awesome, man. And I think it'd be great for someone like that to, you know, I'd love to sit down and have a conversation with someone like that who's respectful.
That was a good comment. That guy needs to leave more comments. I agree.
Yep. Agreed. So I really appreciate that. And let's take one more here. Don't know the name of this one, but maybe they'll leave it. They'll tell us.
Hi, my name is Mladen. I'm coming from Serbia, and I'm a big, 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 big believer in the flat earth theory. So I want to know, how can I ask and give some questions and advice to people who are like speaking in public about flat earth, some kind of my opinions and my conclusions, logical conclusions about the fake globe, then I can help with this conclusion to make another globe believers that start to believe that is earth flat. Actually, it is. I was the globe believer big time, but now I don't believe anything at all about the globe. Thanks. I'm from Serbia, by the way.
All right. Shout out to all our listeners over there in Serbia. Thank you for the call. And I think his question was like, how can he help with some of the points that he sees for Flat Earth, getting him out there? I don't know about you guys. I would say, man, throw him down on a video. If there's any points to Flat Earth that you think are missing, that the speakers and the video makers aren't making, throw them down on a video and get them out there yourself. You know, throw them up on YouTube and let other people know. I mean, if that was the question, I think I understood it right.
I think he was asking for advice on how he could help others explain Flat Earth better. That's how I heard it.
Yeah. So if that's what I mean. So if he's got better ways to explain it, is that what he's saying? Like, how can he?
I think asking how he can help others.
Oh.
Or explain it himself. Either way, it's the same thing. On our website, theflatearthpodcast.com, under FE Artwork, we have the trifold that we talk about. He's already turning it into a Spanish version for Iru. And I'm sure if you click on it, he can translate it into Serbian also.
Oh, nice.
Which I'd love to see.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
Check it out. Go there. Shoot us an email. And you and Andrew can work together and make a Serbian trifold. It'll probably be the first Flat Earth Serbian trifold.
That would be awesome.
So I'll just, if I can elaborate, like, shout out to Novak Djokovic, who's a Serbian tennis player, one of the best tennis players in the world, who's got to be a flat earther, right? Because he knows the earth's not spinning when he's playing. He knows.
Right.
Another great Serbian. One thing that I did, if you're tech savvy, so flatworth.com is my site, but I set up a subdomain and it's mystory.flatworth.com. And so anytime I'm out, like I'm at a concert, at a bar, someone sees me and it's like, dude, tell me about the flat earth. And I'm like, look, you don't want to talk over all the noise. It's like, look, just go to mystory.flatworth.com and you can hear my story about it. Because it's hard to like sit there and like have a debate with someone or explain the entire flat earth deal, you know, while you're at a golf tournament or while you're at a concert or while you saw an old friend at a bar. So if you're tech savvy, record your story and have the ability to send people there.
Yeah. Yep. And then send them. And then send them to some of the videos that got you where you were.
Yeah, exactly. Start a playlist.
Have a playlist, have a way to forward them to it. I think I mentioned last week or the episode before that I still believe that the biggest challenge in sharing Flat Earth with others is the time factor.
Agreed.
It's just not, I mean, like you say, the time or environment factor at a concert, at a football game, or wherever you're at, it's typically not the place to share your Flat Earth story with all the stuff around. Even if it was quiet, you know, even if you're riding in a plane ride with someone, I mean, that's a little better. You've got a captive audience there for an hour or so, but, you know, it's just such a time investment to explain all this stuff. So yeah, I think it's a great idea to have a website, have a blog, have something set up where you can just point people right to it.
Absolutely. And I think one of the boldest things you can do is just flat out say, yeah, I'm a flat earther. And then the conversation starts, right? Like, you're not tiptoeing around it. It's like, dude, I'm a flat earther. Here's the deal.
Mm-hmm. Good stuff. Well, I do want to make sure the caller earlier who mentioned that he was going to be doing the school debate, Diego, if I forgot to mention this when we were talking about Diego's call. Diego, if you do the debate, man, see if you can get someone to video that thing in your class and throw that up on YouTube and let us know how it goes. Send us over a link so we can check it out. I'd love to see it. I think that should happen in more schools, don't you guys?
Yeah, absolutely.
Catch them every now and then on YouTube where people are either debating or someone's in front of a class doing a presentation about Flat Earth. And I love that, man. Worst case scenario, it gets people thinking.
I mean, before television, that's what people used to do for fun, is they'd sit around and watch people debate. We've lost that trait.
Yeah, yeah, totally. So that's we're caught up on the speak pipes for right now. Dave, you got anything else we need to add before we close out the episode?
I just want to encourage people to consider going to the conference.
Definitely.
I'm going to keep mentioning it because it is life-changing.
What about the billboard? What's the latest on the billboard, Dave?
Oh, yeah. Great, great, great.
So Jay and I offered to do matching donations for a week. And that total, Jay does not know yet, is $1,250 each.
Oh boy.
Jay and I will be making that donation right now.
I'll be making my divorce announcement next week as well, but
hey, that should get us done, right?
That should get it done.
But that'll those will be going in shortly.
Yeah, I got to do that tonight. Oh my goodness.
Nice write off.
Just remember that perspective is the imaginary curve. Who said that? Was that Phuket Word?
Hello, Flat Earth researchers, debaters, and debunkers.
There you go. Perspective is the imaginary curve. Who did say that? That is true. I think that's him.
Was it Phuket? Okay. All right.
I think so. Hey, also, somebody took a segment of our podcast and took a short little clip, made a video of it, put a little music underneath it. We encourage people to do that. Please do that. If you find something great, a good little segment, make a video of it, and that'll help wake up more people. Everything that everybody does just adds more people to the Flat Earth soup.
Yeah, are you talking about the, I think it was the Edward Henry mix they did.
Oh, yeah, that's what it was. It was a really good one. I really enjoyed that. So whoever that was, I don't remember who, but great job. Do more.
Good stuff. And Matt, thank you for joining us, bro. You're welcome back anytime, man.
It was a pleasure. I'd love to tell people where they can find me if you don't mind.
Yeah, have at it.
All right, cool. So you can find me at Flatworth on Facebook or Instagram, or you can go to flatworth.com and find me on YouTube, or you can just Google Flatworth. That's Flatworth, like Fort Worth and Flat Earth. Combined Flat Worth.
I see what you did there. That's good.
Yes, sir.
Matt does great little short videos, and it's hard to tell if he's serious or sarcastic. One of my favorites was the when you wanted to be a pro tennis player again, talking about the Coriolis effect. Great stuff. Great short videos.
I have to keep them short, otherwise Dave yells at me.
Yeah.
That's right.
Right. Awesome. All right. Well, yeah, y'all check out.
One more thing. As of the night of this recording, Globusters 24/7 just went live, where they're going to have clips of Globuster shows, other videos, all sorts of stuff mixed in there. A great place to combat the NASA live 24/7.
Yeah.
So now we have Globusters 24/7.
Paul on the plane did the same thing, right?
Paul did another one. So they all have their own little flavor to it. You know, ODD, I think he did the first one. Great stuff. And lots of people just, you know, are on YouTube like, what is this live thing? And they go in there and, as I say, globe heads go in, but they never come out.
So when someone sends us a link to the 24/7 ISS, we can just send them back a link to the 24/7 Globusters.
There you go.
Nice.
Perfect.
Good stuff, man.
All right, everybody. We'll see you the next time Jay decides to show up for a recording.
All right. We'll catch you next time on the Flat Earth Podcast.
They see me revolving on their TV. I know they're all thinking I'm so round and curvy. I'm just too round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy. Can't you see I'm NASA nerdy? Look at me, I'm NASA nerdy. I wanna float above the thermosphere, but so far gravity has got me stuck here. Think I'm just too round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy. I'm just too NASA nerdy. Look at me, I'm NASA nerdy.
First to my class base, can't believe. Landed my module, first try with these. Buzz Aldrin cereal, yes please.
Keep it flat Earth.
I'll take blue marble chief.
My curves never spin to the contrary. You find that they're quite rotationary.
All my lightsabers are scary. Bill Nye's up in my library. My GoPro footage is totally pimped out. Got people begging for my round spaces. I've seen curves over long places. Ain't got no binocs, but I still solve cases.
I outrank all the planets in endless ways. Love NASA orbit, I could watch for days. Look at the sweet moves, you'll stay amazed. Traversing so fast at the place. No inch of the cosmos I haven't run. At gravity, well I'm number one. I do eclipses just for fun. I got a lot of curves and a multi-gun.
Close encounters is my favorite ringtone. I can sure kick your butt at space con. Interrogate any alien you bring on. Fluent in star charts and evolution.
Part I read from. Revolving in the movies. I know in my heart they think I'm round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy.
Can't you see I'm NASA nerdy? Look at me, I'm NASA nerdy.
Wanna be motionless like the flat earth. All the spinning showing off my curve. Think I'm just too round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy.
I'm just too NASA. nerdy.
How to get some press and nerdy.
I've been browsing, inspecting. Globusters, you know I tune in. Foil opinions and deconstruct them. Freeze-dried ice cream, no, it never leaves me bored. Shopping online for deals on rare NASA media. Regurgitate Wikipedia. I memorize the books really hard. I can recite it right now and conjure up dark matter.
Hello?
Pseudoscience ain't a prank, y'all. My friends need advice, who do they call? I do a star blessing for them all. Even made a Facebook for my doll. Yo, I got myself a jetpack. Got it off Craigslist, that's a fact. Spend my nights with a phaser, like that. Zap zap, hope no one sees me. Getting tricky.
I'm Kirby in the extreme. Spent 1,000 plus at the scene.
He was in the Big Bang, primordial suit, and the space beam. And the question I thought was a big deal. Or do I like Bill, or do I like Neil?
These men of science, they are like gods. Spewing theories like alien pods. They see me revolving. They laughing and rolling their eyes cause I'm so round and curvy.
Just because I'm NASA nerdy. Just because I'm NASA nerdy.
Or because I'm blue and curvy. Holy cow, I'm blue and curvy.
I wanna float with the planets, but oh well, I can't get past the firmament.
Think I'm just too round and curvy. Think I'm just too round and curvy.
I'm just too NASA nerdy.
Look at me, I'm NASA nerdy.
Yeah. Mic drop. That's gravity.